Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Century Plyboards India Limited Q3 FY21 results conference call hosted by Asian Markets Securities Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Karan Bhatelia from Asian Markets Securities. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Aisha. A very warm afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We welcome you all to the Century Plyboards India Limited 3Q FY21 earnings con call hosted by Asian Markets Securities. From the management side, we have Mr. Sanjay Agarwal, Managing Director and CEO, Mr. Keshav Bhajanka, Executive Director, Ms. Nikita Bansal, Executive Director, and Abhishek Rathi, Deputy General Manager. I would request Sanjay sir to give his opening remarks.
Hi, Karan. Good afternoon, friends. I am Sanjay Agarwal, MD and CEO of the company, along with Mr. Keshav Bhajanka, Executive Director, Ms. Nikita Bansal, Executive Director, Abhishek Rathi, DGM Investor Relations. We all have joined together in welcoming you to the third quarter FY21 results call of Century Plyboards India Limited. Clearly, it is seen that Indian economy is on right track and growth path post-pandemic, a V-shaped recovery. With next year's budget announced by the government giving further boost to the economy, both infrastructure and real estate sector will see benefits of budget resulting in growth of our company being directly linked to the sector. Overall, there was a very healthy growth both in top line and margins across all segments. I feel proud in announcing that our company has done ever highest in the month of December, and it will continue to perform even better. This quarter was highest in terms of turnover, highest in terms of margins and profit, with practically zero debt towards quarter end. Financially, all ratios improved considerably, and working capital cycle reduced to 51 days. Again, the best in the history of Century Ply. As I communicated in the last quarter call that I am happy to report degrowth on positive side, as plywood has degrown lesser compared to other products in the panel segment. This quarter, plywood has shown considerable improvement, with alone plywood volume jumping up by 17% year-on-year and 37% quarter-on-quarter. Panel segment as a whole grew 11% year-on-year and 33% quarter-on-quarter, which shows sign of growth in our largest segment. I am happy to announce that company has taken decision on expansion of Hoshiarpur MDF facility by adding another line with additional capacity of 400 cubic meter per day and involving a CapEx of around 200 crore. The same will take less than a year to commence commercial production. Apart from this, company is also considering additional MDF facility in different geographies. With these remarks, I hand over to Abhishek to take you through key financial figures, post which we are open to your queries. Thank you.
Thank you, MD sir. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to mention customary disclaimer that this con call is just to discuss company's historical numbers and future outlook. In no way this should be construed as invitation to invest in the company. Results for the quarter, along with detailed analysis, is already mailed to you and also hosted on stock exchanges and company website. Just taking you through the macros, our top line year-on-year has grown by 10% to 654.36 crores against 595.42 crores. EBITDA, barring the exceptional item, was at 18.8%. That was 123.03 crores against 95.54 crores in the similar quarter last year. Profit after tax was at 65.88 crores against 19.09 crores. So all our segment performed exceptionally well with significant improvement in margin. As against debts, our treasury assets are more, so in practical terms, we are debt-free. The quarter under the review was exceptional in terms of working capital cycle, which was reduced to 51 days, as stock depleted due to higher demand. However, we expect the same to be in the range of 60 to 65 days in future. We continue to look at the future with optimism and better performance every quarter. With these words, I open this conference call for question and answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Achal Lohade from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Congratulations for the great earnings. My first question is with respect to this MDF. You know, you have approved the brownfield. Just wanted to get some more color in terms of, you know, the profitability, because I remember earlier indications that the profitability could be a little lower for this compared to a greenfield somewhere else. So if you could touch upon that, what kind of, you know, margins can we see on the incremental capacity, sir?
Hi, this is Keshav Bhajanka here. You see, there are two aspects to the new capacity or to the capacity augmentation that we have taken place. The first is in terms of operational overhead. The operational overhead for this capacity will be far lower. The prime reason being that it is at the same location. The second is raw material cost. One raw material cost, which is the cost of timber, is likely to be slightly higher by about 25 paise per kg or 30 paise per kg. On account of the same, even though we do not see a drop, but on erring on the side of caution, we believe that the EBITDA for the new project will be 3% lower than the current EBITDA margins of the MDF plant.
Understood. And with respect to the greenfield, another, if you could just give the thought process as to, you know, what timeline, what kind of capacity would we look at? Will it be a, you know, switching capacity between particle board and MDF and so on and so forth?
We are aggressively working on the greenfield project. We are focusing on the south at this point in time. I think the capacity, once we announce the same, once our decision is firmed up, which is likely to take place in the next few months itself, within a space of 18 months, we should be operational with the capacity. This is not going to be a fungible capacity. It is going to be a dedicated MDF plant of 700 plus cubic meters.
Understood. And just one more question, you know, in terms of this ply growth, you know, in the entire actually, you know, quarter growth for all segments put together, how much is the extent of pent-up demand, do you think? What is the momentum in terms of the new projects or new work which is being initiated by the customer or the channel partners? If you could talk about that.
Yeah, hi. Actually, definitely there is a pent-up demand that we are serving. But I think we are also probably capturing some sort of market share also, because I think Virokil had an effect, the TVC that we had during Q2 and Q3 as well. We have seen more sales happening than regular market. So I think there is some sort of movement towards our brand. Other than this, new projects are definitely starting. I think there was a bit of start in Q3, but I think it is going to pick up from Q4 more. Given this new budget, etc., I think there is a lot of focus on infrastructure and real estate, etc. So I think going forward, we are expecting that this new project will grow.
Understood. That's very helpful. I'll come back in the queue. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sneha Talreja from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, congratulations and great set of numbers, sir. Just a couple of questions from my end. Plywood segment, an extension to the previous question, it has seen a phenomenal growth. And since you highlighted, the growth has only started coming back. What's your outlook now over the next 2 to 3 years, for specifically for plywood segment, in case you can highlight that?
So, you see, I think this is just the start. Having said that, I do not want to be overly bullish on the same. We will definitely be delivering on double-digit plus growth for the foreseeable future. Having said that, there are a lot of initiatives that we have done that are now beginning to come to fruition. So initiatives such as the change in the go-to-market have now helped us, and I think that this is going to be a continuous boost to our growth going forward.
So can we easily expect a double-digit, like 15% to 20% sort of a volume growth continuing, given that all those structural changes that you were making in the channel and, you know, this retail-based scheme is working well for you now?
We are very bullish on the future, but as I said before, we are committing double-digit plus growth, but definitely the aspiration would be to do higher numbers.
Sure, that is it. My second question is regarding laminates. We've not seen much of the volume growth since you were highlighted. There are troubles with the container availability issues in the export market. Despite that, we have seen a phenomenal margin improvement. What are the reasons for the same, and are these margins sustainable, or is there any one-off related to, you know, lower raw material cost benefit or something that we've got during the quarter?
I think, yes, the margins are slightly on the higher side, but definitely 17 to 18% margins in laminates look sustainable now. And there have been a few fundamental changes that we have done with regards to our pricing structure, with regards to our discounting structure, and with regards to our scheme budget that has helped us. Alongside this, there have been cost-cutting initiatives that we have taken aggressively over the course of the lockdown. So I think all of these have contributed to the margin expansion. Yes, there were certain undercurrents. The raw material price that we got in this quarter was perhaps amongst the lowest that we've had in the past 2.5 years. So I do believe that there might be a slight correction, but we'll definitely be looking at a 17 to 18% EBITDA margin in laminates going forward.
That was helpful. One last question, which is a clarification to something that you pointed out in the pre-post question. What is the margins that you're looking at for the new plant, for the MDF division, you said?
You see, the difference between the existing capacity and the new capacity in MDF, like I said, is twofold. One is lower operational costs, because it is in the same infrastructure of the current capacity. The second is a change in raw material prices as compared to the current price of wood. We are looking at a 25 to 30 paise increase in the cost of wood per kg. So I would estimate that whatever MDF margins we are earning currently, because even these have been volatile, today we are 25% plus, the margins from the new plant would be about 3% lower.
Which is your greenfield plant, or this applies even to the brownfield expansion that you're doing in?
We are talking about the brownfield expansion right now in Hoshiarpur.
Okay, got that. Thanks a lot, Keshav. I'll get back in with you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Karan Bhatelia from Asian Market Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Just to continue on the plywood, you know, if I adjust the exceptional item, the margins have came in at a good 15% plus during the quarter. So what could be the reasons attributed, and what sustainable margins are we looking forward?
Okay. So you see, for us, plywood is a very large segment, and we have certain costs which are actually fixed. So because of the volume gain, it is a bit but natural that the extra gain, extra profit you see, extra EBITDA you see is only because of that extra volume. If we can sustain the volume, I hope we will be able to sustain the profitability or the EBITDA also. But I also think that because of those 2 months, which were zero practically, and if I divide that volume into next, so it makes it that we should get a good 8 months where actually these 2 months can be divided actually. So I believe that next few months at least, yes, we should be able to maintain this EBITDA, and after that it should go down to the original one. That is what I believe.
Okay,
Okay, that's it from my end. I'll follow back.
Yeah, but the volumes are going to go up, and if we can maintain the volumes up, then this EBITDA will actually stay. There is no two things about it. And we have taken too many, you can say, efforts in the market, whether it is go-to-market or whether it is advertising, into our capacities also. We are gearing up all our capacities. Presently, our plants are unable to, you know, meet the demand we have actually. So we are very bullish on the demand right now. For at least, I can say, next 7 to 8 months, yes, absolutely, we are very positive.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'll get back in the queue.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Praveen Sahai from Edelweiss Financial Services. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. And very congratulations on a very strong set of numbers.
Thank you.
First question, sir, related to your plywood. And there is some slight deterioration in the realization on overall plywood segment. So is that of a due to for product mix changes or something?
It's a product mix change actually. Because, you know, the prime plywood growth is there, but the growth in the scenic plywood, etc. is much more. And that is why the overall realization, you will see a little downtrend on a per NA basis if you see, or per square meter basis if you see. That is actually, you know, the fact. And which is actually will keep on happening in future also.
So any contribution of economy segment over this business?
I could not understand you.
So the high premium end plywood and the
economy. That is what I told now. So you see, our main item is the premium item, which is, we call it a Century Prime.
Yeah,
and that has also grown actually in this quarter, but the growth of the economy segment is much higher. Okay. That is why per square meter realization is a little lesser.
Can you quantify that contribution of economy segment plywood?
That, Nikita, can you?
Yeah, so in terms of value, it's around 28%.
Okay, thank you. The next question related to the laminate, as sir, you had highlighted that 17-18% of margin going to be a normal. So this indication is after considering some inflation in the raw material prices?
Yes, definitely. We have already taken a price increase of close to 7% in laminate, and this is to account for the raw material price changes. And if raw material prices change further, raw material costs change further, our prices will change further.
Okay, great. And sir, one more thing about your statement you had made in the presentation, that your strategy, one of the strategy, new strategy you has started to monitor and help sales team, that's OLJ to ODJ. Can you more elaborate on that? What exactly like going to a dealer and giving an order to them?
Unfortunately, you know, this is something that we've been working on for quite some time, and until we drive it to full completion, I don't think it will be right to share further details, but we will definitely keep you updated.
Okay. And any number or quantify the contribution of a VeroKill right now in the business?
VeroKill is an added product characteristic. VeroKill is available in 100% of Century Club Prime and 100% of Century Lamia. So it is not actually a separate product category, it is an attribute. As such, to quantify it becomes very difficult.
Okay. And as you are going for expansion in the MDF, so do we expect the debt level to go up from here?
I think our free cash flow generation is quite strong. So I don't expect debt to spike much going forward. There can be a slight change in the timing of cash flow versus cash generation. But I don't think going forward, there's going to be any substantial debt on the books.
And lastly, sir, on the working capital, because we had managed very well and from normal level, now it has reduced significantly. So as the business is opening across the vertical, your major three verticals are giving a very good growth. Now, So this 50 days of working capital is expected to stay over here or expected to increase?
No, it is going to increase. You see, this quarter, the demand was exceptional. It was far beyond what we had projected. If you remember from our last call, we had said that we would hope that demand remains, or rather returns to normal. But in this quarter, it has moved far beyond normal. So I think that this 50-day working capital cycle is an exception. It is an aberration because stock got depleted quite rapidly. Going forward, I think long term, we'll be looking at a 60 to 65-day working capital cycle.
Great. Thank you for taking my question. All the best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pranav Mehta from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. Congratulations on very good set of numbers. Sir, just wanted to understand on your particle board expansion. So has it been postponed or are you going ahead with the same?
We are not going ahead with any particle board expansion at the moment, but what we have done, we have compensated with some more machinery so that from our existing capacity of 180 cubic meter per day, we are growing up to 250 cubic meter. That has already been now installed, and we should see the result in the coming quarter.
Okay. So my next question was related to your appointment of BCG. So how is that going to impact your strategic thinking going forward?
Right now, BCG has been appointed only for cost control. So it is not impacting any of our strategies at the moment.
Okay, right. And sir, you said you have taken price hike in laminates. So for other segments as well, have you taken any price hike? Because raw material inflation has been a problem for the industry.
Yes, we have taken a price rise of 2% in the whole panel division, and we have taken about 10% price rise in the MDF division.
And sir, in laminate.
And about 8-10% in the particle board division also. Yes.
Okay. Okay. And sir, in laminates, are you seeing more traction in exports or domestic is picking up better for you?
Exports during the initial phase of the lockdown was doing extremely well compared to domestic, but now domestic demand has recovered as well. So I would say that exports is going to continue on a growth trajectory as will domestic.
Okay. And sir, my last question is on the competitive intensity. So how are you seeing things on both plywood side as well as laminate side from the unorganized side?
You see, a lot of times people come up with this notion that there's going to be a radical change in the business because of lockdown or because of other factors, and the unorganized sector will die out. I think, once bitten, twice shy. So what we have seen after demonetization, after GST, after the rollout of the e-label, and now after lockdown, is the ingenuity of the Indian entrepreneur cannot be challenged. So the unorganized sector has revived. I think, yes, we have taken some market share away because of the innovations that we have done, but the disruption in the unorganized sector has not been substantial in any which way.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And sir, just one last question on this Myanmar. Will you see any problem on the face veneer supply because of that political situation that has developed in Myanmar?
No, our factory is still operational.
Factory is operational, and we have started our new factory.
Hello. Yeah, we have started our new factory in Gabon also for face veneer.
Yes.
So if in case there is a problem, but I don't think there will be any problem as far as Myanmar is concerned, because even earlier there was a military regime, and now also again they have military regime. So I don't think it's going to make much of a difference. And this new factory in Gabon is going to suffice for whatever shortage we had, and we were buying from outside. So now we will not have to buy from outside.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That's it from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nihal Shah from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Congratulations, sir, for a very good set of numbers.
Thank you, Nihal.
Thank you, Nihal.
Yeah. Sir, on the MDF side, our margins have now moved on to almost 27%. Now, with the kind of price hikes the industry has seen, and as Century has also taken a price increase of 10%, do you think there's further scope for margin expansion to come in?
Nehal, I think you are much more expert on the industry than us, because you are studying all the manufacturers across the country now. But yes, what you are saying is true. The margins should improve in MDF in the coming time, and should improve quite well actually for some time.
Right. So, if we go back to the last upcycle in MDF, margins actually went up to almost 30-32% kind of levels. At that point in time, obviously, green panel was there. Is the current situation good enough to see margins moving there, or there are chances of excess capacity coming in probably say a year and a half later? And margins are likely to again move downwards.
See, there is only one plant which is going to start in South, which is 600 right. cubic meter per day. At the right. present demand cycle, and our plant which we have announced today will be coming after 1 year. So, and the way kind of growth it has, so I don't think that at least for a year or so, this betting should stay like this only. That is what we guess. And rather, it should stay for 2 years, because any other guy planning the new units will not be able to start production less than 24 months, buying the land and getting the machinery and putting it into use. So I think for 2 years, this product should have a good horizon.
Great. And sir, where's the demand for MDF coming in? Is it more from the OEM segment, which is what we are hearing, or is it from the renovation retail demand?
See, this is the main thing, actually. What you have touched is a very, very important thing. You see, in India, till some time back, it was only the OEM. And today also, I can say more than 85% is OEMs. But plywood shops have started keeping MDF. If suppose yesterday, if 100 pieces of plywood were being used, today maybe 90 pieces of plywood are being used, and maybe 10 pieces of MDF is being used. So it is slowly making inroads. And then there is a product which we call premium MDF, which is actually Action calls it HDHMR.
Right.
That is really catching the fancy of people. And for the first time in last 20 years, I have got calls from dealers who were requesting me to intervene so that they can get distributorship or dealership of that product.
Oh, so
this is a thing which we have actually forgotten in last 15-20 years.
Competes with the marine ply.
With the marine ply, yes. With the marine ply, yes. And but maybe not the marine ply of Century Plywood, because marine ply of Century Plywood is very expensive. So it actually competes with the second grade marine plywood actually.
Sure, tier two brands.
Yeah,
marine ply. Sure. And sir, as far as metros are concerned, have they recovered back to their full potential, or there's still some way to go in starting this quarter?
Actually, all metros have recovered, and our last metro to recover was Bombay, and now Bombay is in growth. So I would say that the whole India is performing well for us.
Oh, great. And so last thing, any color on the CVD or the anti-dumping duty on the thin MDF, and anything are we hearing from the government side?
Nothing till now.
Okay. Thank you, and so all the best.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Prashant Kutty from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, everybody. Congrats on a very good set of numbers. So a couple of clarifications, sorry if this is repetitive. I believe the reason as to why the plywood margins YOY is down is because of Scenic segment doing well. Is that right to assume?
No. If it's not down, you may be saying per capita, per square meter, if you are saying the different thing, per square meter, realization may be down.
Mm-hmm.
But then total, so it's really, really up.
Yeah, I am a little confused, because year on year, the margins are up.
It is quarter on quarter 15.1% EBITDA versus 13.1% EBITDA in September and 15.1% versus 12.4% EBITDA in December.
Okay, this is your reference to the plywood. I was just referring to the entire plywood and allied product segment.
I'm talking about the entire plywood and allied product segment.
Okay. My
there's an exceptional item. So I think that if you are considering, I'm not sure.
Okay. Sure. My apologies. I'll
there is an exceptional item actually. There was some kind of a duty release we had in Guwahati unit.
Right.
We have been now, we have lost the case in Supreme Court. So certain money has to be paid back to the government. So that is a long, you know, after many years we have to refund it. So that may be really showing some data little differential. But otherwise for this quarter, the percentage has improved, the total has improved.
Sorry, just one bit on this part, so extending this in the plywood part. Wanted to ask you, in terms of the premium segment, that was probably even pre-COVID, was maybe struggling a bit. Have we seen revival across the board? When you're talking as far as the plywood segment is concerned, has the premium segment also kind of come back to growth rate? And how confident are we on that part of the business? If you could just throw some light on
that. Yeah, hi. So actually, the premium segment has actually grown for us. But like MD said, the scenic segment has grown more than the premium segment. That's because the market is larger in the scenic segment, the economy segment, the market is larger. And it's a new product that we've come up with in the last 2.5 years. So definitely growth is there. I think there will come a point where we will start selling as much economy brand as much as we do of the premium brand. So, but that does not mean that the premium brand is not growing. Premium brand is growing in double digits.
Okay, it's growing in double digits.
Yeah.
Okay. And is this one of the reasons as to why we are probably more confident that that we probably can actually now go ahead and do double digit growth rates in plywood?
Yes.
Because premium has kind of come back to growth.
Yes, very much. That is our reason for confidence. And we are also actually doing too many things that we feel that are going to lead to growth. So there are too many places that we're trying to plug in the gaps. And this is the year for change. So we are not leaving any stone unturned to actually deliver that.
And Please.
I would like to add one more point. You see, the per capita consumption of wood panel products in India is still 1/10 that of China. So we have a long way to go across all product categories.
Sure. Just one more clarification I could actually ask on the plywood part, which is there. You said premium is growing in double digits. Also want to ask you, have we also right-sized our overall incentive structures and all as far as plywood is concerned? Because I just want to ask you that is there any element of pent up demand over here which we have to take into consideration, or is it just because you feel this is more structural in nature?
See, for 2 months there was no sale. So even if I consider that as a pent up demand, if that is also to be serviced by us, it should take us more than 8 to 9 months to service that demand itself.
Okay.
And this demand has come up, say, from November onwards, actually. So November, December, January, so up to June, actually, even if we say it's a pent-up demand, up to June, I think the pent-up demand will be there. And I believe that from real estate sector, what I hear from my friends and from the markets, whatever I read on magazines and newspapers, the real estate sector, the finished goods sale is really, really very good, especially in all the metros. What I see. So if that is good, then we are not far behind.
Okay, sure. One last question from my end, sir.
One thing to add.
Yeah, sure, sir.
Sorry. You see, for us, when you look at plywood, it is one product which actually does not depend on the construction process. It depends on handover. Once somebody buys a house and starts making it into a home, that is when plywood demand starts. I think considering the way in which demand has taken off with regards to people taking possession and starting off doing houses, it bodes very well for us going forward.
Sure.
Sure, great, great. One last bit from my end on the MDF part. So the capacity which you are adding up, the existing brownfield, that should be up and running by when? What's the target on your mind?
By Q4 next year.
Q4. When you mean Q4 next year?
12 months from now.
12 months from now. Okay. And in regard to the south facility which you're talking about, that you said is still on. So that will actually now come up much later, right? Or is that you will actually start action over there?
24 months from now.
Okay. So great. Thank you very much, sir, and all the very best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Girish Chaudhary from Spark Capital Advisors Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, and thanks for taking my question. Great all-round performance during the quarter. Just following up on the previous participant question on the commissioning of the capacity, which is less than a year. So just to get a sense that how confident are you in achieving this timeline? Have you placed any orders for the equipment, and also if you can give some details on the make of the equipment on this?
We have already placed the order for two of the critical machinery, and for the third should be placed within the course of the next 7 to 8 days. I think we are 99% confident that we'll get the plant operational by next year. We have already commissioned India's fastest MDF plant, which was a greenfield project in 16 months. So I think a brownfield in 12 months when we have the shed should not be very difficult.
Okay. And my next question is on the Gabon unit, which was recently commissioned. Again, here, can you throw some light on how this plant will benefit the overall sourcing requirements for the company, and also the cost relative to the current sourcing norms?
You see, the main objective of the Gabon plant is raw material security. Today, in terms of Occume, the challenge that we face is getting the quality of Occume that Century Plywood requires becomes a big issue, because we only buy the top brass of Occume. The category A or A grade or B grade, as we call it. And the lower grades aren't very useful to us because it does not go well with our plywood. So the Gabon plant will help us to actually source the right raw material that is required for our product. And that will be the biggest advantage. Yes, there will be a slight reduction in cost because we'll be manufacturing there. Quantifying that right now will be a little difficult.
Okay. Lastly, on the proposal to acquire the Century Infotech, I wanted to get some sense here in terms of any reasons for acquiring the stake and who are the remaining shareholders in the company. Yeah, thanks.
The Century Infotech was our subsidiary. We were holding 60.06% of the shares, and remaining certain was with our partners. So we are making it as a wholly owned subsidiary. This company was mainly developed for interior designing through e-platforms. So now we are making it our own subsidiary, 100%.
Any outflow which you can share?
So it will be insignificant. I'll give you the numbers maybe later.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Viraj Kacharya from Securities Investment Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, most of my questions have been answered. I just had a query on MDF. So you talked about us taking a 8 to 10% price increase. And, you also talked about the demand being strong. So I'm just trying to understand a bit more in terms of, when we're seeing the visibility being so strong, where is this actually coming from? So if you can just, kind of give some color. And
I could not understand.
Sorry?
I could not understand the question.
So my question is, given the kind of price increase it is, so will it be easily absorbed in the market? And second is on the demand part, what are we seeing in terms of demand sustainability?
You see, basically you need to understand that the price increase, whatever we have done, has already been absorbed in the market. And as soon as it starts, we will understand the market, because we are every day in touch with the market.
Mm-hmm.
So if it starts flattening, or if there is a less in demand, then we will know
immediately and we will be able to act. But the present situation is not like that at all, because the imports have totally stopped. Most of the imports were happening, say, from Vietnam or from China. So all these countries are now not exporting anywhere because their own demands are quite high, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And the other problem, I hope you understand and you know, that shipping has become very costly across the country, across the world, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And that is causing, this is an item which was valued at about, say, $200 or $220 per cubic meter. On that, actually, $20 was the freight, which has become now, say, $50, $60, $70 or $80 freight is there now. So that is another reason that imports have been totally stopped. So I don't see any changes in coming at least 6 to 8 months or a year's time at least. There are no chances of any imports. And the internal markets have been growing. And there is the capacity expansion, you also know, in MDF there has not been any capacity expansion in last more than, I should say, a year and a half. The only plant which is coming up in South is yet to be started. But I believe that even after that, it will really not matter much.
Okay.
But yes, we all will see the facts by next quarter. We will know better.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jiten Doshi from Enam Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Many congratulations to you, Sanjay ji, and entire team.
All good.
All well. Thank you so much. And
many
congratulations to all of you for fantastic disclosures. Please keep up the good work. I think, the mindset is more important than the size of the company. So I rate your disclosures better than most of the large companies in India. I think you must, very many congratulations to you, Keshav, and all of the team members.
Complete corporate governance. Absolutely.
Right. So I think it's extraordinary. I think Keshav made one comment, and he said that, the unorganized sector never dies. Is there any empirical evidence to say that they will bounce back with the same vigor as they used to operate about a year ago?
I think the lack of information in this sector is one deterrent. But what we have observed is that certain units have been under severe pressure and there have been shutdowns. This is evidenced by the number of companies that have approached us for takeovers, acquisitions, etc., for us to take them over. But having said that, at this point in time, we still don't have any concrete idea.
But do you, because, when we speak to managements across other industries, there's a definitive feeling that there is a lot of weakness in the unorganized or the SME, small scale sector, which is here to stay, and probably the big are getting bigger and they're gaining market share. Do we believe that we are at that cusp at Century Ply?
I will not say that, but there is one very basic fact I would like to tell you.
Right.
The smaller guys, whenever the going is tough, at that time, the price pressure is so high that they have to reduce their prices.
Right.
Companies like Century Ply or a Green Ply, we work on our brand. So even if the costs go down, we don't reduce our prices. Even if the markets are bad, we don't reduce our prices. And we are able to increase our prices the moment our costs go up.
Right.
So in the long term, the sustenance of a small guy, in the long term, I'm saying, I cannot say a year or 2 year or 3 year in the benchmark actually. But in the long term, a survival for a small guy is practically impossible if he does not do adjustment. Mm-hmm. And I believe that Modi government is absolutely after the adjustments. Most of it has been done away with. Whatever little is left will be done away with in a year or two.
So, Sanjay ji, what would you estimate in 3 or 4 years, how much percentage market share would the organized sector take versus the unorganized? If you just could, crystal gaze and give us some.
This question we have been talking, I think, for quite some time, actually, and my expectations have failed. So, I would not like to make another picture in front of you, but would like to watch the movie passing by me. I would not like to make a comment here, actually.
Okay. And one last question, Sanjay ji. What would be the next 2 years capex? Let's put 22 and then F23, because it's a long-range planning that you're doing. And I think you're at the cusp of some huge growth. So what sort of capex are we looking at?
We'll be looking at about 600 to 625 crore capex in the MDF division, which is two new lines. One is the expansion of the Hoshiarpur plant. The second is the setting up of a standalone new entity in the south. Alongside this, there will be some capital addition in plywood and laminate, but that will be more towards balancing equipment. I think that will not be in excess of 50 to maybe 70 crores over the course of 2 years.
Okay, so next 2 years, you'll be doing about 7 to 750 crores at best case in terms of your capex.
Yeah.
And that should all happen from internal accruals, hopefully.
Yes.
Okay. Extraordinary. Very good. Keep up the good work. Congratulations. And once again, thank you so much for the wonderful disclosures to all of you. And
thank you so much.
Happy to have association with a company like Century Ply. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of V. Samala from Tata Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Congratulations on a very good set of numbers.
Thank you.
Sir, my first question is with respect to particle board. So what we are seeing is that from at least the OEM segment, we are seeing a fair share of good demand coming for the MDF. So why is there a divergence there between the performance of MDF and particle board?
See, particle board was not getting imported into India at all.
Right.
And a lot of MDF was getting imported on all the ports, whether eastern, western or southern port, including even North India was also getting some material. So that is why you see more demand gearing up into MDF and not so much into particle board. But the whatever little extra demand into particle board, we are seeing that shows that the overall, the total market of these OEMs and the furniture people is growing. Otherwise, that would not have come. So basically, this demand of particle board is showing me a very long-term gain. MDF may be because of the market and because of the import. But particle board is telling me, no, this demand is going to last.
Right. So sir, then, I mean, if I just look at the YOY growth between both the segments, so MDF is greater than 20% and particle board is low single digit. So then there seems to be...
How will there be a growth if I don't have the capacity?
Okay. So then you are running...
So we don't have the capacity, we have invested some money and we have increased the capacity by compensating some machinery. From 180 cubic meter, now we will be from this quarter, which is may not be whole of this quarter also actually, but we have gone up from 180 to 250 cubic meter per day. That's all. And we are not investing much into particle board because particle board is again, it's a very, very cheap product.
Right.
Very many small manufacturers are coming up across the country. So
right.
to keep competing with them will be little difficult. And whereas in MDF, actually, you have to invest into hundreds of crores, so where small scale manufacturers will not be able to come in, you see. That is why we are building up our brands also into MDF now, that our Century Premium MDF is becoming a brand by itself, actually.
Right. Sure. So moving forward also in terms of capital that you would be employing, particle board would be figuring lower in the pecking order, right? In that case.
Right now, actually, it is not there at all. We are not investing anything more into particle board. We are investing only into MDF and plywood.
Right.
And of course, laminate.
Hello.
Sir,
plywood, yes. What would be the investment? I mean, that you would be planning in the next 2 years?
Plywood in next 2 years, just now I think Keshav spoke about it, about 50 to 70 crores is the total planning.
Okay. Right. And that will be largely maintenance capex only, I would assume?
That is largely?
Maintenance capex and efficiency improvement.
Not only maintenance capex, actually we will be compensating some machineries and we will be increasing our capacity also, depending upon the plant profitability.
So we were actually having this discussion a few days back only. And of course, this has not been even formalized till now. That yes, this is what we are going to do. These are the machines we are going to buy. But that is what plan we have made.
Right. Sure. And with respect to MDF, you just mentioned some time back that you've taken a price hike of around 10%. So what we gather is most of from some of the competitors that they've taken price hike of 4-5%, and then they've mentioned that that is large enough to mitigate the impact of RM price increase. So then are we expecting this price hike to actually be margin accretive?
You see, to my knowledge, that very frankly, whenever we meet our buyers, we always say that our costs have gone up, isn't it?
Right. Sure. I understand. Right. And one last question. So this expansion of 200 odd crores of brownfield in MDF, what's the peak revenue potential which could be expected from there?
Close to 400 crores.
400 crores. Okay, so asset turns of close to 2.
Yes.
Right. And that would be meaningfully higher than what you would be getting generally, right?
I do not get you.
So generally, you would be getting asset turns of close to 1.1 or 1.2, right? On a greenfield capacity.
Yes. So it is a greenfield project. Yes, definitely.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot. All the best for your future performance.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Abhishek Ghosh from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So just a couple of questions, and sorry I joined in late, so if it's repetitive, extremely sorry for that. The first one is that we're seeing a lot of demand for ready-made furniture. That's what the thing is. So if you can just help us understand, is that also driving the overall MDF demand as per your market intelligence? And is exports of furniture also kind of picking up? If you can just help us understand these two things.
Mr. Ghosh, very frankly, you know, in India, we do not have much data. And all of us keep talking, and we have been talking for many years, is only on, you know, the feel of the market. So yes, what you have said is absolutely true, that ready-made furniture is gaining ground, but not really. I must say not really. I would have expected this has to go berserk actually totally, because any young couple today coming into the existence, getting married, getting into a new flat, he should be buying only ready-made furniture. But that is not happening. Most of the people still believe in getting their furniture done as per their design. And there is one thing I always say, that why not? You see, people staying on the Fifth Avenue in America only get to make their wardrobes to their design, because it is too expensive to design and make to their choice. In India, everybody can afford it. You can get your wardrobe made as per your design, because contractors are available on your nukkad. So why not? Why to go for ready-made furniture? But then yes, there will be some who take ready-made furniture. There will be some who will make plywood from plywood. But yes, the demand is increasing. Number of OEMs are also increasing. I think there is a growth of more than 15-20% OEMs every year. And that is the demand growth, more than 20% demand growth we are seeing in MDF every year.
So the whole shift of plywood to MDF, you're still seeing very gradual improvement. It's not a step jump kind of a thing. That's not happening.
You see, if you see figures of China, which we believe are very true, in last 9 years, the plywood has grown more than MDF. In India also, I expect, in European countries, yes, plywood is only 20% of the total panel consumption. But in India, I don't see more than 40% of the total market to be more than 40% for MDF and particle board. And the whole market is growing, actually. So it is not that the plywood market will shrink or anything will happen to plywood market. No, the plywood market is also growing. The overall market is also growing, and the MDF
and ready-made furniture market will also grow.
Fair enough. So just one more thing in terms of the dealer network expansion. So you've spoken about a lot of how you reached out to the demand and you've increased your overall
Sorry to interrupt. Mr. Ghosh, if you could speak a little louder, please.
Is it better now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So where I was coming from, sir, you've done a great job in trying to channelize your overall marketing team, the professionals who are there at the marketplace. But this is there a drive for further increase or penetration of dealer network beyond maybe top cities where the dominance of unorganized would have been higher and this is the time to increase the penetration in those markets? Is that something that you're strategizing?
Yeah, actually, Scenic, the strategy for Scenic is to go to these 1 lakh population towns. So next year, again, we are taking a very big drive for channel expansion. And usually we have seen that whenever we expand for Scenic, we get a growth in even our premium products because there is some sale of premium in those counters as well.
And what is that channel number today and what would be the growth, if you can just help us understand that?
We are planning to add another, so we actually see channel and active channel who builds with us on a quarterly basis. So we are expecting to add another 500 more channels compared to what we are today.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, thank you so much for answering my questions and wish you all the best. Thanks.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Kunal Lakhan from CLSA. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good evening and congratulations on good set of numbers. So in your earlier comments, you mentioned that you're seeing inquiries from some of these unorganized players, for acquisitions or that sort of thing. Just wanted to understand our strategy in the inorganic sense. Like, how are we looking at these opportunities? Firstly, how big are these opportunities and how are we looking at these opportunities?
There are a lot of opportunities that are presently there in the market. Our first priority is how to augment our own capacity at the lowest possible capex, because as you know, that is the lowest hanging fruit and that is the most profitable way to go about it. Post the same, we are evaluating opportunities as and when they come. And if we come up with or if we find something that is extremely lucrative, we will get active on that.
Okay, so you're trying to say that the current opportunities that are there available in the market do not make any financial sense vis-a-vis putting our own capacity first.
It is about our requirement versus what is being offered. Currently, we have good scope to augment our existing facility at a very low capex just by installing some balancing equipment. And that is priority number one. Post that, we evaluate all acquisitions. At this point in time, none of the acquisition opportunities that we have seen have given us or have been very lucrative.
Sure, fair enough. Thanks so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vaibhav Kacholia from VK Capital. Please go ahead.
So congratulations on a fantastic set of numbers.
Thank you.
My question was on the greenfield capacities which we will be putting up for NDF. Will the return ratios, ROI and ROEs on these new plants be on par with our current company level ROEs, sir?
Our return on capital and return on our ROE and ROCE for the new plant will be very similar to the existing plant. It will be slightly lower because we believe the realization in the south is likely to be a little lower than that in the north. That should be offset by the lower raw material cost. But I believe ROC and ROE ratio will be very similar to the existing MDF capacity.
So like, and the margins also, this 3% lower for the brownfield, for the new greenfield, they'll be more or less on par with our current margins?
The margins for the greenfield are likely to be similar to the margins for the brownfield.
Okay, so that is 3% lower than our current margins.
Yes.
Okay.
That is a conservative number, but yes.
Right, I understand completely. And when we put a new plant, Keshav, so we'll be putting like the cost maybe some 400 crores plus working capital of another 100 crores or something like that, right? So on that, we'll be able to manage these I think our current company level ROIs and ROEs are pretty high. So based on these 25% odd margins, will we still be able to manage those kind of ROIs and ROEs?
That is the objective.
Right. So does management have to do something to augment those ROIs and ROEs?
I have not shown that in the present MBA plan.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Got that. And my other question was on brand building. Like, are we using this Virokill also goes into the MDF thing as a tag?
Yes, it does.
So MDF and the Century brand plywood, it doesn't go into Scenic?
No, it does not go into Scenic.
Okay, understood.
It goes into laminate, plywood, Century Club Prime, and MDF.
Got it, understood. And any plans to further augment our brand? Like a lot of these home building brands have used celebrities and stuff. So any such thought processes?
You know, we are a very frugal company. So we try to limit our expenditure in whatever way possible. So we are going to definitely augment the brand in a very, very big way. It might not be virtual celebrity endorsement, but we have a lot of things in the pipeline. And hopefully, we'll show you the results, guys.
I think the management has done a fantastic job. And any more color we can give on brand building and what impact that can have on our operations going forward, Keshav?
We are going to invest in brand very substantially over the course of the next year. Again, as you know, the MD is very strict on the percentages. So we will not go above the allocated percentage spend in terms of advertisement and brand building.
That's 4%?
We are coming up with a very strong campaign. And once we finalize, we'll share more details.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
You seem to have studied it very well. You knew the percentage.
Yeah. So in fact, a lot of other brands in the home building space have used this brand building, and then they have been able to get higher pricing.
Yes.
So we are also thinking on the same process, is it?
I don't think we need to go for higher pricing. You see, our EBITDA is good. And I don't think we need to go for higher pricing. What we need to do only is to expand our sales, expand our market share, actually, I should say.
So got
it. We can achieve that itself, because, you know, the underlying costs, fixed costs in our companies like ours are quite high. And if we can get more market share, actually, the profitability will automatically increase by itself. I'm sure, Mr. Kacholia, you understand that very, very well.
Got it. Fantastic.
Nice talking to you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. And my compliments on fantastic operations.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Akshay Cheda from Canara Robeco. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, sir. Congratulations on your brownfield expansion. Sir, I just wanted to understand the capacity utilization ramp-up that would happen on your brownfield expansion. Like, when we say that the peak revenue that we expect would be around 400 crore, so by what period when we can expect to achieve the same from the day of starting the operation, say 1 year, 2 years or so?
You see, we have already demonstrated the ability to ramp up rapidly in the case of MDF. All I'll say is that we will be achieving capacity utilization in the brownfield far faster than we did in the greenfield.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Karan Bhatelia from Asian Market Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for the follow-up. Sir, how is January shaped up for us across categories? Because we believe till November, December, we were seeing high pent-up demand. So if you can show some numbers on January.
I don't even know whether I can speak about January. I don't even know that, actually. Yeah, but
okay.
Pretty good. Of course.
January was good. I think we can leave it at that.
Okay. That's it from my end. Moderator, any follow-ups?
No, we don't have anyone in the queue.
Thank you. That's wonderful.
I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Yeah. So, friends, thank you so much for joining us on the call and taking your time out for and listening to us. I am sure we will all see a different India. We all will see a different future for all of us in coming time.
this budget, whether we understand it or not, has changed a lot of things. BJP government from a 3% deficit has agreed to go to 6% deficit. So I am sure the future is going to be different. And we will meet again for the next quarter earnings. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Asian Market Securities, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.